Hi everyone, we are so thrilled to be in Lisbon today. We're here for the Web Summit, which is where we talk about everything from crypto to world affairs to media and technology. Let's get down the rabbit hole. And a special place means a special guest. Today, we will talk with Tim Draper, the investor who believed in Bitcoin before anyone else. We will dive deep once again into the infinite world of tokenized arts, catch up on the last 7 days in crypto, and we will unveil the story behind one of the greatest and the most mysterious people in the space, Vitalik Buterin. So that's our journey for today. Grab a coffee, a tea, whatever you want. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. Subscribe and get ready because we're going down the rabbit hole. Before meeting Tim Draper, it's time for our weekly crypto catch-up. So, if you've been looking for a flat or a home this week from your crypto gains, or hugging a pillow crying because you missed the latest meme coin, don't worry, we've got you covered. This is 7 Days in Crypto.
This week on the Crypto Planet, a newly elected mayor, a dangerous new game, and a new Pulp Fiction. They all made the news in the world of crypto. So here we go for a news roundup with 7 Days in Crypto. Destination New York. Politics for starters. What if New York City became the business capital of the world again? That's what Eric Adams is hoping for. He's the new boss of the Big Apple.
I'm the mayor.
He was elected as mayor on Tuesday after beating a red-berried Republican. The former cop entered politics as a Democrat and wants to make his city
the center of Bitcoin.
And for his new ambitions, Eric Adams does not intend to leave anyone behind.
We put on one jersey, Team New York.
Heading now to South Korea. Squid Game, crypto scammers have put the squeeze on investors. The developers of the token based on the famous Korean Netflix series in which the winner takes all and everybody else dies are on the run.
Did you see me escaping?
The price of their cryptocurrency went viral in just a few days before plummeting to almost zero. Buyers couldn't resell their tokens, developers could. And they did. Brutally dumping millions of them on Monday for around $3 million. With no official affiliation with the series and dodgy online platforms, the red flags were flying high. But some investors sadly had no inkling of the risk.
What would the robot do?
The devastating rug pull still didn't discourage a handful of extremely optimistic users. But where is the trickster of the week hiding? On the increasingly lucrative NFT market, we know that CryptoPunks are worth a lot of money.
These punks are business punks.
But we didn't know that they were worth quite so much. A CryptoPunk worth $500 million is a lot. And that's how much the owner of number 9998 claimed to have sold one for. But he got busted. Twitter account CryptoPunksBot spotted that the transaction was a flash loan. That's when the seller and the buyer are actually the same person. And why? To drive up the value of the CryptoPunk to sell it even more expensively the next time round.
It's happening again!
A little tour of Africa. After Leonardo DiCaprio, Matt Damon now wants to save the planet.
Until everybody has access to clean water and sanitation, I will not go to the bathroom.
The co-founder of Water.org announced this week that his organization, which aims to help poor communities, is partnering with Crypto.com. The platform has pledged $1 million to Water.org. Jason Bourne says it's a smart company with innovative solutions. He's visibly more optimistic than his mentors.
Le bureau, dans 20-30 ans, il n'y aura plus.
Heading to LA.
Everybody be cool, this is a robbery!
You've seen it 100 times, but you haven't seen everything. Pulp Fiction, Tarantino's legendary film in which John Travolta still knows how to dance, has not revealed all of its secrets.
You know what they call a quarter pounder with cheese in Paris?
What do they call it?
Royale with cheese.
The director, who was awarded the Palme d'Or in Cannes in 1994, announced a big reveal this week. several scenes cut from the film, some excerpts from the original script, and exclusive comments from Tarantino himself will be shared in 7 NFTs.
I love you, pumpkin.
The Big Tease says that the content will only be visible to the future owners. Too bad for other movie lovers. We finish by returning to New York City. The old Rolling Stone gives in to the temptation of NFTs. The famous American magazine, created in 1967, announced that it was launching a collection with Bored Ape Yacht Club. It'll include two covers featuring the famous digital monkey. Rolling Stone will also physically publish two magazines with the swaggy monkey. It'll be hard to get a copy, though. The edition is already sold out. Well, that's it. 7 Days in Crypto is over. We'll see you next week for a new tour of crypto news.
Now we have the chance to speak with a leader in the economy and in finance. He's a person that has made some real big bets, and they've turned out pretty well, like Tesla, Hotmail, Skype, and many others in the cryptocurrency space. So we're going to talk to him today, so you have a chance to know what might work tomorrow. Please, everyone, welcome Tim Draper to the show. I'm going to go get Tim, and we'll sit down and find out what's going on in crypto this week. Tim, thank you so much for joining us here today. We are so pleased to have you here at Web Summit.
Great to be here at Web Summit. I'm so excited to be a part of going down the rabbit hole.
I mean, we are too. So much so that the audience is clapping. They don't even know it's for you yet.
No, I think they're clapping for the last group.
Well, I don't know about that. But listen, you're one of the original leaders in investing in cryptocurrency. 7 years ago, when many other people turned a blind eye, you jumped right in. What kind of gave you the confidence and understanding in the space to make that choice?
And I put it on a ledger.
And you put it on it. Keeping it secure.
So it wasn't a confidence thing as much as, actually, I overcommitted.
Okay.
I didn't realize how much I was going to commit. When I bought the U.S. Marshals Office auction, I got them all.
Mm-hmm.
I thought maybe I'd get one or two lots out of nine. I got all of them.
You're like, well.
But I was kind of okay with overcommitting,
mm-hmm.
because before that, I did try. I bought about 40,000 Bitcoin,
mm-hmm.
and they disappeared into the Mt. Gox fiasco. And so I kind of felt like I had to make that up. And so I went and I bought more. And I have always been very excited about it because, to me, Bitcoin represents freedom, across border, the ability to understand a currency that can be used anywhere around the world and free and open trading of it. And I also like the trust aspect because it's that trusted third party without having to deal with a bank or the government or whoever. And so now we've got this freedom and this trust currency, and that got me all excited.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. I mean, there's no one else that's actually involved other than your ability to make your own choices. And so I do wonder, you know, we've seen more city and state experimentation around DAOs and getting involved in cryptocurrency. Do you think that there is a future with nation states as cryptocurrency and Bitcoin rise in popularity and adoption?
Well, if you go out far enough years, there's no nation states. I don't believe.
By when? When do you think
I think that the geographic borders that we all operate with are going to be null and void. They probably should be now, but in the 5-10 years, you're going to start seeing some of these borders become much more porous and allow people in and out, because most of the world has risen pretty high. And so being like known as an American in a special world, it's not as special as it used to be. And so we don't need the borders. We certainly don't need the trade wars. I think that customs is going to be a thing of the past. I think my grandchildren will ask me about customs at some point, and I'll explain to them that was a way of keeping people out of a country or in a country and they'll say, well, that's stupid.
Yeah.
Why would you do that? Because by that time, they're going to be people of the world. They're going to be free to move around and operate around the world. And governance, I think it's going to be a service that is provided to people, and people will be offered the right to choose which government that they want to operate with. And I think that's coming, and not fast enough. I think it needs to come, but it isn't. It's coming, but it's not coming fast enough.
Well, I think you bring up this point, right? We have these global crises, we have climate refugees, we have so many issues of inflation, different need states, what's going on in Lebanon. What do you think is actually the moment that will force nation states' hands to either adopt cryptocurrency or say, to your point, we need to work differently with other people around the world for what's happening?
Well, it started to happen already, of course. El Salvador is open for business.
Yeah.
It's all Bitcoin there. Japan was the first country to say Bitcoin's a national currency. Panama is following El Salvador's suit. So is Ukraine.
What do you predict for the United States in this?
So I think the bigger countries are going to be reticent to do it because the U.S. has been able to sort of draft off the dollar for a long time, and they don't want to give that up. But they're printing so many of them that they're discrediting the dollar, and so people are going to want to buy Bitcoin instead of the dollar. And I'll tell you, the moment that I can buy my groceries, my clothes, and my housing all in Bitcoin, that'll be the moment I don't need fiat currency anymore.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, why would I ever hold any fiat currency when I can buy my food, clothing, and shelter all in Bitcoin? That moment will come, and it will happen very quickly.
Your grandkids will also ask, what was a bank?
Yeah, what was a bank, or what was this all about? You know, why did people operate this way?
And what is the relationship, you think, talking about these larger companies, with China and the choices it's making around cryptocurrency?
You know, I think China, it's the roar of the dying lion.
Mm.
What's happening is they're saying, oh my gosh, you mean there's a currency for the world? That means we don't get to control our people the way we used to. And so they're going back in time and saying, we've got to lock down these borders, and we got to make everybody the same, and we've got to make them all, you know, do my bidding and whatever. I think China's making an enormous mistake. Not only did they have some of the best crypto companies in China, but they had 40% of the mining capacity in China. And they've lost the whole thing.
Do you think there's a chance, though, they're just saying that to hold on to it for a period and then come out as the strongest competitor?
No. I think he wants to control everything.
Yeah.
And so he's going to have a digital renminbi that they're going to force all the Chinese to use. And people will have, it'll have less and less credibility because it won't be accepted everywhere.
By everyone.
Bitcoin is accepted everywhere.
Do you think
was an Aurora coin?
Yes.
Ever heard of Aurora coin?
Yes, actually.
Okay,
yeah.
That was the Icelandic coin. Iceland said, we're going to do a cryptocurrency, and it's called Aurora coin. And I was all excited. I was thinking, oh, that's so great. And then I found out that it's only for Iceland. And I thought, oh my God, they missed the whole point.
It defeats the purpose.
They missed the whole point.
Yeah, yeah.
China, it's bigger, but it's the same problem.
And you recently made a prediction that we actually asked Peter McCormick about on this show, that Bitcoin would reach the value of $225,000 by
250.
The end of 250.
By the end of 2022 or early 2023.
Okay.
And I've stuck with that.
And you've stuck with that one. He pushed back against it. Okay, you still think you're holding strong.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's getting, back then it was like at 4,000, people thought I was completely nuts.
Yeah, yeah.
Now they're going, whoa. 62, 63.
Maybe he's on to something.
1,000? He's pretty close.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I didn't realize, I mean, I might have been low because I didn't realize that
It would be higher.
How much inflationary pressure was going to come on the dollar.
Yes. And, well, that's true.
And that may even boost it higher, but let's just stick with my prediction. It'll hit there, we'll all be good.
Okay, if I'm correct, you've invested in more than 50 cryptocurrency companies. So I am curious, as you've gone through that
diligence. 50.
50, right, yeah.
50.
Yeah. Learning and experience. What's actually one of the biggest things you think people get wrong about crypto and about the emergence of Web3?
I'll tell you what I look for, and that'll maybe help you think about what people might have gotten wrong.
Yeah.
What I look for are really dedicated entrepreneurs, engineers who are spending all their time creating something around a DAO or a cryptocurrency or a NFT or whatever, and they're just totally dedicated.
Yeah.
And so it's really the people that drive these things, not the, you know, the fluff of the market.
Right.
And you could get caught up in the fluff of the market and get caught in some coin that you think is going to be great, but there's really nobody behind it.
Right. I've seen a few examples of that recently.
Yeah, you want to make sure that you're, if you get involved, you want to get involved in something where you're really...
systemic you change, know, how you've talked about.
You know, there's a real systemic change, really good team working on it. And a future you want.
Right.
A cool future.
Future you want to fight for.
Yeah.
But I've heard you talk about as well about predicting that there could be crypto integration into Netflix, some of these media players. And I think about that a lot, right? Like, how does media and Web 2 kind of fit into this Web 3? So how do you think about that?
So I actually think that not just media, but almost all industries are going to be very... interestingly affected by this new world.
Yeah.
And in the media world, let's say you're a movie producer.
Yeah.
If the way it currently operates, let's say you have your Star Wars and you have those 15,000 people you have to send checks to every quarter or something.
Right.
And they always get it wrong and the guys are always mad and they don't trust the media business and all that. Well, what if it were all put all into Bitcoin wallets and all build on a smart contract? And that smart contract could know every time that movie played on Netflix.
For royalties and pay for
the royalties would all, you get a tenth of a Satoshi every time this thing plays. And then it would all be trusted and all honest. And so that's really going to change that industry. I'm excited about changing the venture industry. I can't wait for the time where I can raise a fund in Bitcoin, invest it in a bunch of companies in Bitcoin, and then have them pay their employees and suppliers in Bitcoin and have it be a complete closed circle so that I don't need the accountants, the auditors, the bookkeepers, the transfer agent, none of that because it's all built into the system and built into software. And the tax authorities can benefit from that too because they can build in a tax. I actually think that will change the whole nature of finance.
And now we're going to talk about someone else. Someone who started using his computer before he knew how to walk. He was 7 years old when he started writing his own encyclopedia. He wasn't even 20 when he became a senior editor at Bitcoin Magazine. And of course, he wasn't much older than that when he created the Ethereum, the blockchain his name is forever linked to. And to really understand who Vitalik Buterin is, we met his mother, his father, his teachers, and former colleagues. This is Vitalik as you've never seen him. This is The Story by Ambreen Bedida, Gabriel Moret, and Gregory Rodier.
You could see very early on that he is a very bright child.
My mother, his grandmother, always said that he is going to do great things.
Vitalik is a genius in many things, computer science, in mathematics, in cryptography.
Everyone sees Vitalik as a leader.
That's Vitalik right there in the middle.
In the school yearbook for Vitalik, they wrote Steve Jobs 2.0.
When you put a genius in all those disciplines and you combine that with a person of extreme integrity, it's a superhuman combination.
This is the story of a child born in Russia who's now one of the most influential men on Earth, Vitalik Buterin, the man behind the creation of Ethereum. As intriguing as he is brilliant, the 27-year-old's a mystery for those who don't know him and a visionary for others.
The vision for Ethereum has always been going beyond finance.
From Canada to Europe, we followed in his footsteps to understand his success story and to meet those closest to him. His dad, his mum, and also the man who first believed in him, Joseph Lubin.
He had a reputation already, and then I found out that he was 19 years old, and I was pretty amazed.
To know more about his childhood, you have to go to Canada's economic capital, Toronto. It's here in one of these skyscrapers that we meet with Dmitry Buterin, Vitalik's dad. At 49, he's also a tech entrepreneur.
He's about 2 months old, and that computer in the background that I think eventually became his toy. So here's him playing with that old computer that we gave him. So this is Excel, and he's writing formulas and stuff. I'm not sure how old he is here, like maybe 4.
Dmitry moved to Canada in 1999, leaving Russia because he was uncertain about the country's future. Back then, Vitalik Buterin was just 6 years old.
He was this little guy in his pajamas. He's like looking around. And actually, when he was 7, he produced this awesome document that's like 20 pages long. And it's called Encyclopedia of Bunnies, right? It's a whole universe. Like, you know, here's bunnies, they live there, and here's the speed of light in the universe. It was charts and images. So when I looked at this, I'm like, wow, this is amazing. He wasn't public school system until before high school, and he was in a gifted program, right? But you could also see that the public school system was not doing enough to support kind of his potential, right?
Vitalik's parents decided to move him to an institution where he could make the most of his gifts, the Abelard School. Brian Blair, his former politics, Greek, Latin, and philosophy teacher, remembers Vitalik's time in class as if it were yesterday.
He looks young, I would say grade 9 or 10 probably. But again, pensive.
Today, Vitalik Buterin's a role model to Abelard's students.
He was actually the guy that inspired me to go into computer science. Hopefully I can create something like he did.
But yeah, it's kind of daunting though.
Yeah, it's daunting.
Yeah.
It's a huge accomplishment.
So. Yeah, exactly. He had this intellectual curiosity that is very rare. He wanted to learn things in real depth. I remember one time we were reading Plato, and he thought he had spotted an error in Socrates' reasoning. I got him to write it out for me. He almost proved that Socrates was wrong, so that was great. Yeah, he was great to teach. Fantastic memory. He's good at visualizing things. And he worked hard, too. He really didn't have weaknesses as a student.
After he graduated in 2012, he enrolled at Waterloo University to study computer science. That's around the time that he discovered Bitcoin, after his dad mentioned it to him. Vitalik became more and more interested in blockchain technology. Eventually, he even co-founded this publication.
I kept a few Bitcoin magazines. He is like 17, 18 years old, and I'm like, oh wow, he's a senior copywriter.
His passion saw him eventually drop out of college after winning the prestigious Thiel Fellowship, which won him $100,000 for his Ethereum project. An idea Vitalik developed in his white paper, The Bible of Ethereum, more than 30 pages, in which he explains that the Bitcoin blockchain is too limited. With Ethereum, the possibilities are limitless. He first presented his ideas to the world in 2015.
Decentralized applications for finance, cloud computing, messaging, and distributed governance are soon to come. Ethereum is a platform that is specifically designed for people to build these kinds of decentralized applications.
Ether is based on this technology. The cryptocurrency launched in 2015. It quickly became a huge success, from 1.25 to around $4,338 today. But that's not all. Ethereum also allowed the creation of NFTs, a revolution in crypto art. And in the future, Vitalik even wants to develop social media. His idea basically changed the world and created a whole community that meets up a few times a year all around the globe. Recently, it was Portugal, in the beautiful streets of Lisbon, for the Ethereum convention. It's here that we meet Natalia Amelie, Vitalik's mum. She's in Lisbon with her longtime friend and business partner, Elena Sinanikova. Unsurprisingly, like her son, Natalia's a computer scientist.
We were suspecting that, you know, he will make some contributions in life, yeah, to society. As a kid, he was super smart. He learned to read super early and, you know, do the math very fast.
I remember he was like a year and a half or something like that. So we were having a party and there was this plastic cups on the table. And he started counting the cups, like first in Russian, like один, два, три, четыре. So he counted up to 20. And then he started counting in English, like one, two, three, four. I was like a year and a half years old. He was like, oh my God, this is unbelievable, yeah.
Absolutely.
I'm not a mother, but I'm still proud of you.
Well, I'm super excited that he invented the project that allowed for so many people to go about and build their dreams, right? And so we also are trying to build our dream, right? Elena got an idea of CryptoChicks. We were trying to set up Ethereum wallet, and It got proven to be a very difficult task. If, you know, the two of us with a computer science degree is having a difficult time, how hard it must be for other women. And hence the idea was born to start an organization that will help women to learn about blockchain in a safe environment, have fun along the way, and, you know, grow together.
Like them, Joseph Lubin came to Lisbon to meet with the community. He was one of the first to believe in Ethereum. The Canadian entrepreneur is now a guiding force in this fast-growing blockchain industry. Today, he advocates for decentralized technology, a far cry from his days working in traditional finance.
I had been a technologist for most of my life, but also spent some years in the finance industry, and I was growing increasingly disenchanted and depressed about the financial state of the world, the economic state of the world, the geopolitical state of the world. Centralized systems were morally and financially bankrupt. I got the tremendous potential of cryptocurrencies, blockchain, decentralized protocols from reading the initial Satoshi white paper. But that technology was a very limited technology. Vitalik wrote his white paper in November of 2013. His vision was the most expressive, the most powerful version of any that anybody had seen. It was a slam dunk to people who really understood what was going on. And so it was very exciting when I met Vitalik. It became very clear that it would be something that I could choose to trade 6 or 7 years of sleep for in order to jump in and be heavily involved.
Vitalik Buterin's awakened a passion in everyone gathered here at Lisbon's Botanical Garden.
He's like icon, and I think every community needs their guts. And for example, we can call blockchain one of blockchain gods.
I think Vitalik is someone that has a vision. He puts out papers, he puts out ideas, and then other teams take it and make the product better. They own it.
No one imagined that Facebook or Google or Amazon would be built on top of the internet, and we're just at the beginning.
A beginning of great things. Vitalik's supporters are convinced that his technology has not yet achieved even a fraction of its potential.
All of the hard work, you know, it's finally coming to fruition.
If you're a normal person, you don't understand what's going on.
It's a cliche, but it's true, you know, the sky really is the limit.
He clearly has a capacity to take more things on and contribute in many more ways, so I hope he does.
Going back to you, Tim, one of my last questions to you is, have you actually ever met Vitalik?
Yes.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, he's very interesting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very, you know, clearly very brilliant and totally into his software.
Where do you find resources to learn? Because you're constantly around such interesting and kind of creative people. I mean,
that's how I learn.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, I ask question after question. Same way you're learning.
Same way I'm learning. Same way our audience is learning.
Yeah.
And one last question I have for you. What's going on in Lebanon? A lot of individuals are getting, you know, crypto and blockchain from the dark web, from markets, because of the different need states going on. As we know, this is happening more and more around the world. How do we kind of help help and not just observe in the adoption and allowance so that, you
It's the same thing that's happening in Nigeria and Venezuela and wherever there is not a trusted government. If you don't have a trusted government, what do you do if you're an entrepreneur? Let's say you're in Nigeria and you want to start a business. You want to build wealth. What, are you going to build that in Naira? In Nigerian Naira, they're going to drop 50% a year in value. So you build this thing of value and then you lose it to inflation or government corruption or whatever. Well, if it's built in Bitcoin, you hold it. You keep it. And so naturally people in countries where they don't trust the government are going to be the first to adopt Bitcoin as a store of value and a use and a way of building a business, something to build a business around.
You know, there have been so many, obviously you've had great success with Robinhood. There are many other players in the space. Do you see it as something similar to the monopolies of now, where a few will continue to rise to the top? Or will there be many different players in the space over the next decade to come?
Well, you know, there are some rising stars.
Yes.
There's Ledger and Coinbase, and there are a few that are definitely going to be there in the future. But there are also these new things happening and new technologies, and they may rise up in some way that none of us could ever predict.
Yeah, it's so true. We can't know more than we know right now, which is what's so exciting about the future of Bitcoin and the blockchain. It's evolving it with us.
Yeah, and I get to meet with entrepreneurs who are projecting out 5 or 10 years every time I talk to one.
Yeah.
I get a new picture of the world and what it might look like.
Yeah, it's a pretty incredible place to be.
And so it kind of helps me kind of anticipate what might be next.
Well, what is the one thing you want our viewers to think about what might be coming next with Bitcoin and crypto?
Well, I think your viewers should at least start by getting a ledger and put some Bitcoin on it. They will have this feeling of freedom and trust and independence that they would never have had with putting all their money into a bank that's run by a bunch of people in suits. You know, why? And they are run by a government behind them that is just making them fill out forms. All of a sudden, you've got your currency right here.
That's it. You're good to go.
You can loan it out.
Yeah.
You can pay for your shopping. You can do any number of things. You control it right here. So just go out, get a ledger, drop some Bitcoin on it, and all of a sudden, your world will open up in ways you never imagined. And there are all sorts of new things that are going to happen because people are going to do that, and they're going to say, whoa, if that's the case, then why don't I do
this? The trail-on effect,
yeah.
Well, we take that advice. Thank you, Tim. Thank you for giving us so many insights today and joining us down the rabbit hole. We hope to have you back again sometime soon.
Great. I appreciate being down the rabbit hole. I've lived there most of my life. It's
amazing.
A wonderful place to be. I highly recommend the rabbit hole.
Echo that as well. Thank you so much.
Terrific. My pleasure.
It's time for us to go one step deeper into the tokenized world. This is The Deep Dive with Karim Warbaj.
Welcome to The Deep Dive, your weekly cultural journey into the new world of tokenized art. Artists, people, businessmen, politics. It's the place to be.
Virtual reality.
Non-fungible token.
I'm going to Disney World!
Metaverse.
NFT.
Who, how, when, why. We'll tell you everything in The Deep Dive. And this week, we're going to talk tattoos. And if you think that the relationship between crypto and tattoos is limited to this, this, or this, we'll show you that the connection is much closer than it seems. And although we have a good idea of what a tattoo is,
well, duh.
Let's indulge in a little definition. It always sounds professional. So, a tattoo is a mark, inscription, or permanent drawing inscribed on the skin with needles and inks. Performed for aesthetic, religious, or symbolic reasons, the art of tattooing has existed since the Neolithic period and is considered to be a form of permanent body modification. Secular and planetary, the art of tattooing has undergone multiple evolutions over the centuries in its technique, its approach, its philosophy, its perception, until the latest one. Instagram. Yeah, in just a few years, the social network has given tattoo artists an incredible tool to build a reputation and grow their business much more easily than in the past. Where their elders had to scour specialized magazines and conventions to hope to gain some recognition, artists no longer have to travel to gain exposure, sometimes worldwide.
Tattoo parlors that say they've increased their business by like 90% of their new customers, they say, they get from people seeing something on Instagram.
As a result, artists are more and more known and appreciated, and more people want to get tattooed.
The effect of Instagram has caused for more people to say, you know what, I'm going to go get a tattoo.
And yet, this circle is not as virtuous as one might think, because if tattoo artists benefit from more visibility, they also have the other side of the coin. Their work is often copied and stolen by other tattoo artists.
Problem is where it's like some shops trying to fake it till they make it, and the problem is with those shops who don't make it.
In light of this problem, the American artist Scott Campbell has found the solution. This tattoo superstar, considered one of the best of his generation, and who has in his clientele personalities like Robert Downey Jr., Orlando Bloom, or Courtney Love, had the idea to launch a platform for selling tattoos in the form of NFTs. That's right, allourbest.com.
You're gonna own that thing, you're gonna own that design. And, you know, it might be unique, it might be a small edition, whatever, you know, whatever the artists want to do. And then getting it applied to your skin as a tattoo is an option, you know, is secondary.
Among its many goals, allourbest.com will enable artists to sell and certify the authenticity of the work sold, as well as their exclusive rights to buyers on its marketplace, which is the basis when we talk about NFTs. But where this platform really revolutionizes the tattoo world is that the works will finally benefit from a certain form of memory.
What do you mean?
Think about it for a minute. We're talking about an art form that is thousands of years old and is practiced all over the world. Yet no historical artist is recognized as a master of this most challenging art. Historically, tattoos live and die with their wearers. Well, problem solved, because the tokenization of works brings a solution to this impermanence.
All right, explain this to me like I'm a two-year-old.
By creating crypto assets tied to the rights and the representation of the works, tattoos can be transmitted from generation to generation, and the unalterable character of the blockchain is there to certify it. Tattoos thus become eternal.
I have tattooed myself, and I would like to turn them into NFT, because this is something that I will be able to pass on to my child. And I think that's a nice kind of heritage.
In the same vein as allourbest.com, the French company Eternal also offers tattoos in the form of NFTs and sees aspects related to the art of tattooing that we never thought of tackling just a few months ago.
At some point, your body is filled with tattoos. You cannot collect them anymore. You can collect them as NFT. There are people that would have loved to have tattoo, but would not consider to have them on their skin.
By creating a second market for NFT tattoos, because yes, it's now possible to resell a tattoo, these platforms also create the ability to invest on young artists and intends to eventually bring the tattoo into the world of classical art trading.
I want to change tattoo culture. I'm really excited about it because I think it gives tattoos kind of stature in, you know, that's on par with other fine art mediums.
And where the revolution is even bigger is that the creators and the artists will be more valued. Generally speaking, tattoo artists have often been paid according to the time spent on a piece. The process of tokenizing the tattoo transfers value to the piece. Instead of assigning a price to the application of the tattoo on the skin, it is the artwork itself that becomes valued.
We're selling you the actual image.
There are an endless number of tattoo artists who can tattoo an image that a client brings to them. But the real value of a tattoo artist lies in the creation, in his or her very own visual language and artistic characteristics. NFT tattoos will therefore value the creation and not the sole execution.
Like if the tattoo is the painting, the NFT is the signature that certifies it.
And that's not all. When you buy your tattoo as an NFT, you'll be able to wear it on your avatar, which you'll be able to wear in, yes, the metaverse.
I could, in theory, technically, have that when I'm in Zoom. I can have it when I'm in Grand Theft Auto. I can have it when I'm in Fortnite. I can have it when I'm in Roblox. Like, that's technically what's possible with this.
In many ways, cryptocurrencies and tattoos share common values. And what seems to unite them closely today is that they are movements that came out of the counterculture and are on their way to becoming mainstream. And for purists who think that the digitalization of this art is taking artists away from their audience, let's just say that even while paying in crypto, the skin is still at the end of the tattoo artist's needle. Well, the deep dive is over for today. See you next week for a new dive into the tokenized world.
week, we talked to Tim Draper about the future of nation states and why he's betting on Bitcoin. We learned why Squid Game should maybe just stay a game and not enter the world of cryptocurrencies. And on top of that, we learned about the person behind the mystery, Vitalik, and the future of Ethereum. So with that, go on ahead, take your cup of tea, lay back, take a nap. It's a lot to digest. Subscribe to our YouTube and have a great week. We'll see you down the rabbit hole next time. From Lisbon.